Good morning on this snowy Monday morning, and welcome to this Arts Month community conversation. I'm Jonathan Toman with the Cultural Office of the Pikes Peak Region, and today we're excited to bring you Dance, Soft Skills, and Saving the World. This is the seventh of eight community conversations that will take place throughout the month of October, and the first within Music and Dance of Week of Arts Month, the final week of Arts October 2020. These community conversations, curated by local artists and arts leaders, will showcase a variety of timely and relevant topics within the various arts sectors of the Pikes Peak region. Today, as I mentioned, that topic is dance, soft skills, and saving the world. The moderators and panelists for these community conversations have been exceptional, and that streak continues this morning. Joining me now is Jordan McHenry, who is the executive director of Colorado Springs Dance Theater and today's moderator. Hi, Jordan. Glad to have you.
Hi, Jonathan. Thanks for having me.
Jordan is the host of Dance on Air, the podcast, a top contributor to DIY Dancer magazine, and a Leverhulme choreographic scholar from Laban Conservatoire of Dance in London, England. Born and raised in Colorado Springs, under the direction of Zeta Alderman, Jordan has trained internationally at programs including River North Chicago, Jacob's Pillow, Alonzo King's Lions Ballet, as well as Springboard Dance Montreal. Jordan assembled three wonderful panelists, and we'll introduce them momentarily. One housekeeping item, these four will have complete creative control of the conversation. That said, I will get out of the way and let Jordan get us underway.
Thanks, Jonathan. Well, first of all, thank you everybody at home for joining us on this snowy Monday morning. I hope everybody has their cup of coffee to start us off with a hopefully Monday motivational experience about how dance builds soft skills and how soft skills save the world. So I would like to introduce the three panelists who are here for this discussion. First, I'll introduce Shawn Womack, who is a dance professor at Colorado College. Prior to being a dance professor at CC, Shawn was a choreographer and a dancer herself and owned a company of her own. Thank you, Shawn, for being here. Secondly, I'd like to introduce Aoi Koenig, who is natively from Japan, who moved to the United States for her schooling and is a professional dancer and mother and educator. And hi, Aoi, thanks for joining us. And last, I'd like to introduce Jeni Kemper, who is a professional dancer and studio owner and their director of Kemper Dance Academy here in Colorado Springs. Hi, Jeni. Thanks for being here. I'm just going to say that this is such an incredible panel, and we had a warm-up discussion last week where there was really inspiring conversation in and of itself because we were able to really vibe off of the content that we wanted to share with everybody today. But I'm gonna start by just rereading the topic of today's conversation, which is dance, soft skills, and saving the world. Our bodies possess a profound quiet knowledge if we listen. Cultivating this listening is a potent antidote to many of society's ills. Inwardly towards ourselves and outwardly with our community, dance can be a mechanism for radical kindness. And with this conversation, we hope to explore the impact of physical expression as a catalyst for change in the modern world. So what does all that mean? I don't know. I don't know if there are answers to all of this, but I'm excited to explore them with you guys today. And my very first question, and this is very lofty and big, but let's start with you, Shawn. What is dance? And Shawn, make sure to unmute yourself to perfect. What is dance is the question.
Sure. First of all, thank you, Jordan, for inviting me and Aoi and Jeni to do this. It's just such a pleasure to talk with all of you as dance artists in our community. When you asked this question last week, it's such a big philosophical question. And I often think about how to answer it is to not answer it directly, but indirectly, because really in the context of the moment between the dancer and the witness or the viewer or the audience member, that's the magic of dance. And in different contexts, historically, culturally, in the street, on the stage, in the dance studio, dance becomes very different things for different situations and for in different circumstances and different for different people. Sometimes it's just to delight and entertain, to wow people with the prowess of the dancer. But sometimes it's a moment in which the dancer and the viewer or the witness come together to experience something together in a very felt way, emotional way. Other times it's all about the articulation of the body to communicate something very directly, maybe even socially or politically. So it can mean very different things. It can be very different things in different situations. So I think I answered with a non-answer.
No, I love that approach, because part of one of my goals for this conversation was to recognize the fluidity of the definition, right? So Jeni, can I ask you the same question? What is dance to you?
So dance to me, I believe, is very emotional. It's an emotional part of life. When you watch a toddler, you know, show his emotions without speaking, he uses a lot of his body when they are doing that. For example, I have a son who's 2 years old, and when he's, you know, frustrated with us, he'll like throw his hands. And of course, you know, somehow that relates back into, you know, being frustrated. So to me, dance is expression, it's emotion, it's something that everybody does. It does not matter if you're a dancer or if you're a regular person. You use dance to make a language. It's a language for some of us.
I love that segue that you just provided me, which is that it's accessible to everyone. Everyone has a body that they have a relationship with and express through. And this universality of our human agreement is, we're all dancers. There's a truism in this sense. Ali, how would you answer this question?
It's a personal one. And I know that I can probably speak from the true place. For me, dance has been, since the beginning, I was a kid, I was maybe 7 or 8 when I started with ballet anyway. But for me, it was the safe place. It was a joyful place. It was a free place for me to be a part of something. How do I say it? It felt like that's where I could breathe, that I could stay without words, whereas at school or just generally in the society, I felt as a young person I couldn't stay, or I couldn't just be who I was. So when it came to dance classes, although it was ballet, it was just the space, the empty space, the dance floor, the music, and then the body, and just unexpressible thoughts or emotions, even as a kid, so much was going on. But so dance has always been that sort of place for me. And it really is a form of therapy, if I can put it like that. It really is just a beautiful element that I dare say I need to reflect on life, whatever that's going on. I need it to filter it so that I can really experience it in my heart. Sometimes life is just way too much for all of us with different elements, but when it comes to dance, I get to do that.
I would hearing everybody say, and what Ali said was that it was freeing, and this concept of liberation that happens when words aren't enough to express yourself, or and the expression is sincere and generative out of the body, this language, that it is freeing. And so I want to take this idea into the next question, which is slightly separate, but just in life as a human, what do you think are some of the, and I'll start with Jeni here, what do you think is some of the most important aspects of someone's character just to succeed in life? And I don't mean as a dancer. What do you think is really important?
To me, for, you know, especially, you know, now in the world that we live in now, it's acceptance. It's being able to change with the, you know, with what is happening. A lot of dancers, you know, there's, you know, it's interesting because it's it's hard to explain, but
adaptability.
Yes, adaptability for sure. Because dancers, you know, we adapt to so many different things, especially, you know, if you think about 2020, for me, for example, you know, with the studio, we went into this quarantine and I had to quickly within 1 week change my entire in-person studio and put it virtually. And so for all of us, especially with our dancers and, you know, especially my 2 to 3 year olds, like they had to adapt to the fact that they were not in person. They were not seeing their friends. They were not seeing their dance teacher, but we were doing it all, you know, on computer. And I think, you know, that's a very important skill for a lot of us, even not as dancers, is to know how to adapt, how to accept, how to, you know, just have the kindness of, you know, having somebody standing next to you that's not the same color, same person, same race, you know, whatever.
Yes.
And still be kind to them. So, and I think dance is a great way of helping us support that in the world that we live today.
I love it because Jeni wrapped up what I'm wanting to achieve. No, that's great. And that gives us a route forward. But Shawn, let me throw these words to you, acceptance and adaptation and flexibility. These are words Jeni used, and how do you feel those words are important to living a well-lived life and being successful just as a human?
So I absolutely think that Jeni hit the nail on the head with adaptability and flexibility, and it's certainly something that dancers practice daily as a discipline. And we find it in this time that adaptability and flexibility to change when circumstances aren't what you expected is really important. And I think the other part of that is resilience, the ability to continue to adapt and be flexible and to change as change arises. Is really important. It's like, you know, the reed that bends, that doesn't break, that comes back up to upright and then bends again when the weather changes and bends the reed. And I think these are really important skills for us right now during the pandemic. And there's something about dance training and being a dancer that teaches us that through the discipline of dance and the humbling that it takes to practice dance every day, to experience movement in your body when your body feels different every day. So yes, to adaptability, flexibility, and resilience.
I would agree for sure. And I'm gonna throw a couple of other words that we threw around in our previous conversation. Listening skills, communication skills. I'm not going to throw this up on the screen, but clear communication. We start to realize that as dancers in studio space, we have to communicate with our bodies, with other bodies, just in agreement, unspoken agreement, which requires a certain form of listening, which requires a certain form of taking responsibility for oneself. And I think just to get us to this point, that these are soft, these come in the set under the umbrella of soft skills. Mm-hmm. And dance uniquely is set up to facilitate this in our students. Mm-hmm. More, maybe not more so, but in a very unique way compared to other art forms or other disciplines or sports or all disciplines and diasporas. But so we've kind of landed on this idea that dance creates soft skills, but Aoi, can you think of any specific experience you've had as a teacher, dancer, or parent that can highlight this better for us?
Big question to answer clearly, but I think as a student myself, and as a teacher, and I'm just gonna talk to you. I have a little baby here, so I'm just gonna take away this banding toy. All these soft skills that we're talking about for life, well, Shawn said it in a way that I would completely agree. It's the day in, day out, day over type of experience that a dance student can experience over time. As I was listening to you all in the last minute or so, the word grit came to me. But grit in a way that's not, that's a toy. The grit that's not like harsh and hard and just like plow through anything type of hard. It's not that kind of grit, but how Shawn put it as the reed, the plant, the reed, that sort of staying power with gentleness, understanding, but it's a certain element of grit, like once again, that word grit. I feel like the dance really cultivates that in us, dancers, students, yes, the people who dance and train in dance for overtime. And that kind of grit or the strength within, the focus, that to me, that soft skill, that is so beneficial and so much needed to live a life, especially through a world pandemic like this. It's just so confusing to all of us. Very exhausting, extreme. But I was also having this one mind picture. I come from classical ballet background heavily. So I was just having this back attitude balance on demi point forever. and how you just really day in, day out, you practice that. And some days are terrible. Some days you feel like just quitting altogether. Some days are awesome. Some days you feel like I got this. And then the next day it's like, what was I thinking type of crazy. So I think in the studio, a student can experience all these inner practice. It's not just the struggles, it's the inner training.
Can I jump in on this? Because I want to reference back to the question, which is when I talked about in the topic, which is inwardly towards ourselves, how can we create a relationship of acceptance? And you hit the nail on the head when you talk about how you show up one day and the attitude is in perfect humming place and you do three perfect pirouettes and things are great. And then the next day you show up and you see yourself in the mirror and you've gained 2 pounds, you're bloated, you didn't sleep well the night before, you're not hitting the turns, and you're in front of your job or your friends or your peers. And you all of a sudden have to renegotiate a relationship with yourself that's about acceptance. Because yes. because you're not as proud of yourself as you could potentially be, or you didn't meet your expectations of your own expectations of yourself, because you know you could potentially have done better. And so you're always confronted as a dancer with your where yeah. you're not good enough. To some extent, and you have to accept it because you have to persevere, you have to grit, you have to use all these things we just talked about.
Yes.
And so dance, for me personally, I can recall being, you know, 21 or 22 in New York City and being at my 10th audition where it was, there was 100 million people right next to me who looked exactly like me, and it might inner dialogue is, well, they're better, well, he's stronger, well, he's cuter, or, and I'm sure that dialogue is happening to every single one of us. And so to take it away from the personal, but to put it into the public and the community, everybody, we have to acknowledge that every person is having a dialogue with themselves about inner acceptance. Yeah. And dance is a unique space where that is very visceral and present all the time. And because you do that all the time, you get better at it. You get better at treating yourself with kindness. And this is a skill, skill that dance is uniquely positioned to help with, to wrap it all around.
We learn.
Yes. And so let's move into dance and community, dance and culture. So now we recognize that dance facilitates soft skills within us individually, but what type of skills does it allow communally that I think are super key right now in life to treating others? Does anyone just off the top of their head, can they think of something?
I mean, so bringing like it into the culture, so we have at the studio this amazing program for our special needs dancers, our JEDI program. And before this program had started, we have a dancer at the studio. His name is Jamin Morales. And he grew up with the kids. And so, you know, the kids who had danced with Jamin, I mean, this has been for, he's been with us for 10 years now. But before we had this special needs program, he was dancing with, you know, just in regular classes. And the kids, you know, what was so sweet and special to me is that they never looked at him like he had special needs. He did not communicate. He has, you know, zero communication. He is autistic as well too. And the kids always were like, oh, that's Jamin. And so they always, you know, played around, you know, they did games with him and they incorporated him in class. And so the fact that, you know, through dance, these sweet little children did not even see that this kid had a special needs, and was able to, you know, accept him into their group. And even still today, I mean, they're all 14 to 16 years old and they still hang out with him and still think he's super cool. And Jamin sees them as their best friends. He gets so excited when he sees them at the studio. But the fact that we were able to at the studio, you know, teach these children how to accept, you know, other people and things like that, you know, and also adapt to the fact that, you know, he didn't always listen all the time. He didn't always, you know, follow or stay in his line. You know, dancers in their lines, you know. So, but he's, it's amazing. And even in school, like they said that because of dance, he has, you know, been able to have this, he's in high school now and he's been able to have this great high school, you know, year just because he knows how to communicate with his body and how to, you know, communicate with everybody without using his words, but he's able to do it with his body. And so, it's just amazing how, you know, dance can bring that acceptance and that world of culture together, especially with Jamin.
I think that's a perfect example about how Jamin got a lot of skills from being in dance class, but everyone else in the room also was receiving benefit through this radical acceptance. Like in the dance space, everybody is equal to some extent. There's an equanimity that exists, and then I mean, we can always work for a more equal space. That's not what I, there is definitely sincere systemic issues even in dance. But what I mean is that when you're in the dance studio, there's an unspoken acceptance of everybody in the space. And the earlier, like Jamin has Down syndrome and us, and the JEDI program is built for, is it, I'm not sure if it's just children with Downs, but explain.
So it's actually a program that's designed for everybody that has Down, or, you know, with Downs plus other special needs. So autistic, you know, anything, you know, nerve and whatever else down the road, you know. So we do have children that are in wheelchairs that are in our program. We do have children that have, you know, walkers and things like that. So, but right now, 90% of them are Downs in the program.
I see. And so this is healing for them in a way. And so when we talk about dance as a healing mechanism or emerging as a language of therapy to some extent, we're talking about it as a social and political subject all of a sudden, I think. And maybe let me backstep. Aoi, you said something earlier about dance as therapy. And can you talk about dance's therapy in a universal way, not just as an individual?
Yes. Well, I'm a person who was born and raised in Japan. So if you haven't been there, I'll tell you, Japan is like a different planet. It's a very different society to grow up in. And I feel, in terms of therapy, whatever that is oppressing the person. For me personally, it was more mental, emotional, abusive type of elements from my past. But whatever that is oppressing the person, I feel like the dance has this tremendous power to unlock your heart. Even the bodily memories of trauma, those things are somehow unlocked in a safe way, holistic way, to process somehow. And then somehow through dance and dance therapy, it transcends. I don't know, Jordan.
Perfect. Wait, this is because it unlocks something. And I'm going to use this segue into a documentary film called Rise. And Shawn, I'm going to come to you after we show the clip. But this documentary film, Rise, is the narration of the development of crumping in inner city Los Angeles in the late 90s and the early 2000s. And crumping really arose from the anger that was created because of the Rodney King riots in the early 90s and the racial disparities happening in inner city Los Angeles. So we're gonna go to this clip of Rise so I can show you just a bit of what I'm talking about and what Aoi just totally hit on, unlocking this therapeutic aspect.
This is not a trend. Let me repeat, this is not a trend.
Out here, it's a flow, it's a vibe. Everybody does it. You never feel
pain expressed like the best place to get the real truth is right from the street.
A group of us got together and we invented this.
We have stripper dancing, which we do not do. You have clown dancing, and then you have crump. The crump dancing.
First time I saw a drag queen get crump, I thought he was on drugs.
Like hygiene, either you smell good or you don't. Either you crump or you're not.
It's like getting out your anger for all the dance floor.
It's not dangerous, it's lying.
Gangbang,
it's a competition. The crips go against the blood.
That's how Thomas started the thing called the Metal Zone.
Battle Zone.
Battle Zone.
Battle Zone.
It's like that same competition, but it's on the flip side. We have the little mama match.
We got big
boy left. But we never see anything like this again.
They telling the people that they better than us?
You going down tonight. Somebody wants to be better. Somebody wants to be noticed.
Rolling Stone calls rock.
So I find this documentary so moving. And in that clip, everybody could hear the clip, correct? You heard them say that they were expressing pain. And this language emerged in these inner city communities. And it's now social, it's now political, it's now healing. It's these things. So I'm going to throw it to Shawn and maybe ask Shawn to contextualize this for us more. Maybe.
Thank you, Jordan. What occurs to me in this dance is it's a form of protest against injustices. And in this case, the injustice of being Black in America. And the dance isn't just about individual prowess, but it's a form of expressing and standing up to the injustice of a particular community in the United States, or in this case,
I would have a healthy way, a healthy outlet, right?
Well, yes, but also in a very truthful way as well, so that it's there's anger, but there's also power in the movement and the dance and the rhythm itself that's affirming of a community. It's not violent, it's productive, it's not even productive, it's creative, and it's expressive. And I think in this case, the dancers are vehicles, their bodies, their expressions are vehicles for a positive social change.
Absolutely. I love the word affirming that you used, because so much about, I think, societal ills nowadays is not being seen, not being validated, not being heard.
Mm-hmm.
So communities are not being seen and not being heard. Mm-hmm. And through the rise of dance, people start to be seen and confirmed. And that is, you know, one of the most profound feelings. And I've been there as a dancer, and I'm sure we all have been there as a dancer. Mm-hmm. We felt seen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And does Jeni or Aoi, do you have anything to say about the rise of the documentary or this idea in general of community and healing?
I was just gonna say, you know, especially just talking about voice and being able to use your voice. I have a cute little dancer at the studio who was very, very shy. Her mom gave me a little bit of background, and she was worried to talk to other people because she always thought she was going to say the wrong thing, or she was afraid of what other people were thinking. And because of dance, and because we promote so much self-love, and we promote so much, you know, being able to communicate with other people or being in the space with other people, she has now, she's now able to, you know, walk into class and raise her hand and ask the teacher a question. Or she now has friends at school that she, you know, communicates with and she's able to hang out with, because she used to, you know, be the cute little girl that was sitting there all by herself with no friends type of deal. So I think, you know, us, especially with using RISE and using, you know, all those things, like, dance has been a way for a lot of us to communicate and a way for a lot of us to use our voice. I know that, you know, there's a lot of shows out there. There's a lot of productions out there that, you know, for us, they're all personal in some way, especially when, you know, for me, a lot of my combos are how I'm feeling at the time. Or even how I feel like my kids are feeling at the time as well too. Just this past weekend, we had a guest teacher in our studio, and all of my, you know, 15 and older kids came out crying because they were like, this is exactly what I needed. I'm so emotional. And you're like, okay, great. So, but, you know, and it's a lot of times it's just a way for kids to feel at home. It's a way for the kids to feel like they belong. It's a way for them to feel confident to use their voice and to be able to speak out. And Rise is a great example of that. They use dance to express how they were feeling to the world and the community. And that documentary is definitely one of my favorites, for sure.
Yes, and I'm thinking about emotions now and how I remember as a student having great emotional experiences with teachers or mentors and the floodgates opening, you know, and the tears and the healing that I felt that was present, even though that was not the objective. You know, dance was the objective, but healing was just such a clear result. I think that's really interesting. It's an interesting link that I think can be explored more, which we're exploring now, in the big view, the 30,000 foot view of how to save the world. You know, do we go into communities? No, not go in. Is there a way to facilitate in communities that are struggling with expression, or struggling with violence or social repression or all of these things? There's a way to actively use dance as a tool and say, no, let's get dance into these schools. Let's start earlier. Let's get people having a relationship with their bodies at the beginning in order to allow a foundation of all of the things we've just talked about, self-healing, self-acceptance, all the soft skills. So the last major area of conversation today is kind of, that's the segue. How do we start earlier with kids and just people in general to introduce healthier brain-body connections and relationships that do facilitate these skills in later life? And so before I get into the science of the brain, which I do want to talk about a little bit because I think it's so important, and what we've learned about the brain in the last decade is monumental in regards to understanding the growth of a human being. Aoi, I'm going to throw it to you. You have 4 small children, correct? 4. And they're all quite young. And you have a unique experience. You have seen children at a very young age develop. Can you just start to talk about that? Your brain body development.
Yes, as a mom of 4, my kids are 7-month-old baby boy, 3-year-old girl, 6-year-old boy who's in first grade, and 5th grader girl who's 10. What I'm seeing day in, day out, at home, that is, it's not even in a dance studio or anything like that, at home, they are already dancing, meaning like they're moving, right? Moving their bodies in a way that we adults might have forgotten. Meaning they're moving their bodies according to how they're feeling. Even in the kitchen, if the 10-year-old girl who tells me, Mama, I'm not like you, I'm not gonna take dance, I don't like it, type of thing, but she's still expressing her emotion in the kitchen. Or even the littlest baby, he is just moving and moving and moving and doing stuff all day long. And I feel like it starts when the babies are in their tummies, really.
Can I interject? I apologize. So, the movement moving, moving. I'm going to interject a small story about a star, this starfish story that I just recently learned about. I'm just going to mute. Perfect. So the story goes like this. There's a starfish, a specific species of starfish that lives in a specific part of the ocean that when it's born, it has a brain and a neurological, all its neurological parts, including its digestive tract. And then it travels along the bottom of the ocean and parks somewhere where it knows it's going to continuously get food. And then it stays there. It embeds itself into the rock. And as soon as it's done this, the digestive system digests its brain. Because now that the starfish is not has no need for movement, there's no need for a brain. And I'm going to throw this map of the brain up on the screen and see if you can see it. It says brain structure and function. Just let me know if everybody, say yes if you can hear, see it.
Yes.
Yes, great, thank you. What I'm getting at here is if you take a look at any map of the brain, almost every section of the brain is devoted to something that involves movement, voluntary movement, involuntary movement, balance control, vision and perception, sensation, body awareness. This is all over the brain. The brain developed evolutionarily to help us with moving. So then I'm going to direct everybody's attention to the front part of this picture, the red part, the frontal lobe. The frontal lobe is really what evolved latest in human evolution, and it is what is responsible for all of our executive functioning. So the things that make us human, like our memory, our problem-solving skills, our planning skills, our impulse control, our ability to stop, to reflect, and adjust our behavior. This all developed in our brain late in the evolutionary process, and this is what makes us human. My point about this is that if you give a child the space to reflect on their own identity, move, be emotional, all simultaneously, you're lighting up the brain in ways that a lot of other activities don't do. The coordination of the body against the emotion, against the outward perceptions and the inward perceptions, the body is lighting up with the brain. And so I don't want to keep going because it just excites me so much, but I think that there are ways we can incorporate this early on with children. And yes, Shawn, please.
I also want to say that I think it's absolutely right that children must move. And, you know, in our culture, we tend to put them in bouncy chairs and confine them, and movement is part of their development. But I also want to say how movement can be healing for people with brain injury or with Parkinson's disease, or Myo Dance Company has a program, Dance for Parkinson's, in which they teach classes for people with Parkinson's disease, and that even later in life, movement can be a regenerative force for brain healing, as well as at, in the early developmental stages of young dancers dancing, or young bodies moving.
Jeni, can you add to this as a teacher of a lot of students and a lot of younger students?
Yes. So starting at such a young age is an amazing thing for the kids. A, it just gets them to think again for themselves. We as at Kemper Dance Academy, we decide to, you know, reach out to all of the daycares around town and see if during the summertime we can come in and, you know, teach a couple of classes just to get the kids moving and grooving. We've reached out, you know, to also the schools and stuff, but What's amazing is that there are, high schools and middle schools and even elementary schools out there that have now started incorporating dance into their, arts program. And it's now part of their gym class and stuff. So that's amazing. But I mean, dance, again, is just one of those things where if you watch your kid, they are dancing, they are moving. So getting them into dance early, does start develop the brain a little bit earlier. It does start, they mature a little bit faster. They also learn how to work as a team and work with others, and having the patients to wait in line for their turn to go. Dance is, amazing.
That's so crazy. Patients can just stand still. It's really difficult for children and humans and adults, but there are times when you have to have bodily control.
You're totally good. But it's so true. It allows kids to be who they are, learn who they are, but at the same time, learn the patience of having somebody standing next to them or having someone stand in front of them. It might take a little bit longer for them to go across the floor, and then it's your turn. But again, we said in the very beginning, dance has so many great skills. They help teach us learn how to take feedback. It helps us learn, how to work with others, even if we don't like the others. It's taught us a lot of patience. It's taught us a lot of adaptability. I am a big supporter of dance, and I always have been, and I will, that's the reason why I started the studio, is just to help create great individuals for the world, even if they don't become, the next ABT principal dancer or, the backup dancer for Beyonce at the Super Bowl. I want to make sure that we have great people and great humans for the future and for the world to come.
Yes. I think that's a perfect summation of what I was trying to facilitate in this conversation, which is connecting these loftier ideas that they're obvious. Everything we've spoken about is plainly obvious to anyone who takes 3 seconds to think about it, I think. But also at the same time, if you're not given some of those basic fundamental connections, how would you ever know? And that's why I revert back to the very first question, what is dance? And that we're just talking now about human movement so much, and expression. And that maybe as a man, as a male in dance, I calling it dance all of a sudden defined it in a way that was held so much cultural weight. Right now I was a boy in dance class, but I was just a physical expressor, and the label of dance was maybe too narrow for me in moments. And that's why I want to ask us to expand our definitions of dance so that we can bring our children into movement sooner without defining it for them. And this also comes to this question of the westernization of art. We have been accustomed to thinking that dance falls very closely to classical forms like ballet and modern and jazz, even, which I now still think is firmly within form. Dance is so much more than what's happening in form. Dance is when you're in line at Starbucks. I've said this before, waiting for your Starbucks. Dance is when you're angry and you're 2 years old and you're expressing yourself to get attention. Dance is holding your partner after 50 years of marriage and just rocking your partner to sleep. It's body expression. And so opening the definition of dance, I think, will help us use it as a tool for the future. Yes, Aoi.
Yes, I'm fired up. I feel you. I feel you so much in my heart. Because dance is the expression of you as a whole. You know, your heart, your soul, your spirit, your mind, your body. It's vital for people, if they have not experienced it through their vessel that they live in. They have body, but they may not have experienced that sort of connected way of being. Ah, that's life. You and I know it. It's life. So, yeah, I can't find words, but my goodness, it's vital.
Shawn?
Yeah, I think Aoi just said that so beautifully, and I've also been thinking about our bodies not as instruments that some self lives inside, but our bodies as part of ourselves, as ourselves. And I often tell my students when we start a dance class at Colorado College is that the body isn't an object, but it's a source and a site of knowledge. And we learn so much about ourselves and the world and how to build relationships, not just connections, but actually relationships where we're feeling and empathetic toward one another in ways that is very powerful. And so this kind of bodily knowledge that dancers carry with them is so, so valuable to the world. One of my teachers, Liz Lerman, who had an intergenerational dance company for many years in Washington, D.C., encouraged dancers not to hoard their knowledge, but to bring that knowledge out into the world, into other communities, whether it's the JEDI program or it's the Dance for Parkinson's, or working together with dancers, working together with people with traumatic brain injury, or whatever that is, or being a parent of small children and allowing them to move, you know, so all of that.
So just to finish up and to bring it back into our scope, and by our scope, I mean, we all live here in Colorado Springs or right in the Pikes Peak region, and all of us work with our community very closely. Maybe there's not a question formed here, but what about Colorado Springs can we do? And this is maybe, I don't mean directly, but how can we help our local Colorado Springs community share in that knowledge? Mm-hmm. And maybe there's not an answer. Maybe I'm just throwing it out there.
I would just say take advantage of everything that's out there. For example, this weekend, Jordan's beautiful group, you know, Colorado Springs Dance Theater, has an amazing Halloween thing going on where, you know, the kids will learn Thriller, and just get those kids out there and experience, or even just have a dance party. I believe that, you know, same program, Colorado Springs Dance Theater has, you know,
dance break. You're right on it.
Jordan, what's
dance
it called?
Yes.
Yeah, and just turn on music. I know that, you know, for us, like, especially, you know, because I have a 2-year-old and then I have a 14-year-old. So, like, we just turn on music and we dance around in the house. And, you know, God bless my husband. And he does, you know, he dances very well in his own little sense. But, you know, and we all just get together and we have a fabulous time. But it's just bringing that together. Like, even if, you know, you are a boy and you're like, oh, that's dance. Well, imagine it this way. It's a room full of beautiful girls and they all dance around you, and you could meet some amazing people if you just try dance, even if you just try it in hip hop. There's a lot of beautiful programs out there, a lot of great dance studios that could be right next door to your own house, and jump in, try it out. I know a lot of us have open houses. A lot of us, you know, have free dance classes available to our community. Just jump in, try it out, see if you like it. Who knows, you might be the next Chris Brown or, you know, Missy Copeland out there. They all started late, so. Yeah.
I just want to say that when the pandemic hit, I was so impressed with the dance world and how it so many people quickly went online and figured out how to dance in one's own home. And there's tremendous resources online right now if you're still feeling safer at home, that there are a myriad of ways to dance, and you can find a world of dance even online during this time. And then once we can all walk back safely into the world, then go visit all the amazing dance studios and dance opportunities in Colorado Springs.
I thank you so much, all three of you, for being a part of this conversation. I appreciate this, the opportunity to pine your knowledge. And I also am thankful that we all live in Colorado Springs together all of a sudden. I feel very unified in this conversation. And I invite everyone who's listening, dancer or non-dancer, to just open up your eyes to the world of dancing, even if it's in your own living room. And thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you so much.
Yeah,
it's been amazing.
Yes, thank you. And thank you, Jeni and Abby.
Yes,
thank you.
Everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Jonathan.
Thank yous all around. I appreciate you, all four of you, joining me and joining us this morning for this conversation. What a great way to start a Monday. Through a lot of it, I was reminded of the John Denver song, "Some Days Are Diamonds, Some Days Are Stones." But the positive collateral damage that dance and the arts can have for ourselves as a whole. So I really appreciate your time this morning. Our final community conversation is tomorrow at 2 p.m. That is What Makes a Healthy Music Scene. David Siegel from Grass It Up, the local bluegrass band, will be our moderator for that tomorrow. Hope you'll be able to join us for that. In the meantime, you can watch all of these previous community conversations and check out more about Arts October, because it is Arts Month for another 5 days or 6 days. My math is rough early in the morning, but it's still Arts October, and you'll see all the conversations plus more details about how to get involved at that website. Thanks again for joining us this morning. And remember, as part of Arts Month, to have at least one new cultural experience, virtual or in person, in 2020 with family or friends this October.